Welcome to this session. I'm Abhinivesh Jain, and today I'm going to present on designing highly available stateful applications in Kubernetes. So why do we need to design such application? See, what is happening right now, Kubernetes usage is growing day by day, right? And in edge computing and many other spaces, Kubernetes is going to be used primarily. So and various companies wants to use it for holding all kind of data. It's not only for web application or a stateless application. Companies want to use it for their mission critical application hosting also, where high availability is extremely important. So we are going to look at various options about this. So brief introduction about me. I'm Abhinivesh and I'm an author, speaker and blogger. I'm an open source contributor. I'm working on Akerino and I'm distinguished member of technical staff in Wipro. So today we are going to talk about some of the key concepts which are related to storage in Kubernetes. And then we will see how do we really design highly available stateful application. All right. And I'll quickly summarize whatever we learn in this session. Okay, so let's do a quick recap of very important terms, right? So what is stateful application? And then we'll see a few Kubernetes constructs like PV, PVC, storage class, and we'll see how these are really helpful in designing such a highly available solution. So what is stateless and stateful application? Before getting into that, we must note that Kubernetes was originally designed for stateless application, right? And making a stateful application run in Kubernetes requires special consideration, right? And in a stateless application, as the name suggests, state is not preserved, right? It is stateless. So if a pod restarts, whatever data you have generated during that pod runtime, it will be all wiped out, right? And a stateful application, it is the other way around, where you want to preserve that data, right? So let's say you have launched one database. I think database is very good example to understand a stateful and stateless application. So database is stateful application, right? Here you want to ensure that if my pod restarts, which is my database pod, then my records that I inserted inside the database should not be deleted. I mean, I don't want to do that again and again, right? And I want that state to be preserved. Right? Now, stateful set is another concept in Kubernetes, but that is not same as a stateful application. So we should just remember that fact. Now, coming to Kubernetes storage construct, volume is a directory. Right, and there are two types of volume, ephemeral volume and persistent volume. Persistent volume, as the name suggests, is volume where data is persisted, right? And this is the way Kubernetes assigns storage, right? So if you have a large chunk of storage, you create volume out of it, or you create persistent volume out of it, and then you utilize that volume using persistent volume claim. Kubernetes supports several volume types. Here is a big list on the right, right? So you have option of using cloud provided disk, like you can use EBS, you can use Azure Disk and so on. What is PV? PV is piece of storage. It could be static or dynamic. And we can have several different type of PV in the same pod, right? And here is a small YAML file that talks about the persistent volume. Okay, so let's go to PVC. What is PVC? So PVC is way to allocate storage to a pod. So pod doesn't understand PV, it understands only PVC. Right? So PVC is all about consuming PV resources, right? And it is always one-to-one mapping. So one PVC is equal to one PV. What is storage class? So storage class is used for dynamic storage provision, right? And how do we do that? I mean, we just create a storage class for a particular category, right? And then we, instead of giving PV to PVC, we just mention the storage class, and PV creation happens automatically or dynamically, right? So that is storage class. Now there is one more construct given in Kubernetes. It's called host path. So what is host path? Host path is again a persistent volume, but as the name says, host path, right? So that storage is coming from the host where your Kubernetes is running, right? And it is mounted as a directory there. It has several security risks, so it is not at all recommended. Host path is very common in non-production scenarios, but definitely not recommended for production. So one of the example given here, so what you're doing here, you're just saying, in a spec, you're saying host path, and path you're giving MNT data. Now MNT data is coming from your local server, local data plane node. All right, so once, after we have understood these basic concepts, let's understand and do a deep dive on how do we really design highly available application. Okay. Now, to design high availability application, first we need to understand what can go wrong, right? What are the possible failures for which we need to have a consideration in our design? Now, what can go wrong? Almost everything can go wrong, right? Pod can crash, the node that is hosting the pod, it could be a control plane node which is running Kubernetes, or data plane node which is running your application, that can fail. Underlying storage can fail. Even the entire Kubernetes cluster can fail, which is hosting your application, right? If you think further, cluster might be running inside a data center, right? That data center itself might fail. When I say fail, there might be some outage to data center, right? There could be the city level problem, right? The entire power grid might go down in that city, and not only one data center, but multiple data centers can go down. Or there might be a disaster at even country level, right? So considering these various failure scenario, obviously a frequency of these scenarios will be different, right? So if I go bottom up, then something affecting entire country is like extremely unlikely, right? Some war or flood or earthquake or something like that happening is not very common, right? So it's perfectly all right not to worry about country or even continent level, but the mission critical system do have cross country or even cross continent DR, right? So, But we do consider at least at data center level, if not beyond, right? Data center and city level. Okay, so how do we handle? Let's take one thing at a time. So let's say if pod crashes, what do we do? All of us know that Kubernetes has a concept called deployment, right? So deployment automatically takes care of pod failure, right? So what happens when you create a deployment? It creates a replica set, and you define how many replicas you want. And Kubernetes will make sure that if one pod goes down, and let's say you have given three replicas, then it will bring that pod automatically and ensure that there are always three replicas of that pod are running. Now, pod might be just fine. I mean, no issues with the deployment, but what about the data plane itself? If node failure occurs, then you should use multiple nodes for data plane. How many nodes? So see, there could be possibility of control plane going down or data plane going down. So for highly available setup, we need to have minimum of three nodes, right? So odd number of nodes for control plane is always recommended. And for high availability of data plane, you should have at least two nodes, right? So that one node failure does not cause your workload to go down, right? So that means you need to have five node cluster. Now, this is the bare minimum, right? Based on your load and several other factors, you will have bigger cluster, right? And similarly, let's say you want to have two node failure. capability. Then obviously with two control plane or two data plane node, you can't do that. You need to have three then. Right? So those are like other consideration that one has to take care of. Now, how do we handle storage? Okay, so let's say node is all good, deployment is running fine, but storage is having problem. So before going into storage, we need to understand how are we allocating storage to our pod? Is it the host pathway, right? Then I think the first suggestion is don't use host path. I mean, because that will become single point of failure. Host path, what happens in host path? Let's say you have two nodes in your data plane and you have deployed your application, right? Now, and you have given persistent storage coming from host path. Let's say it is running on node one. So then if node one goes down, if that storage of node one goes down, there is no way that data is getting replicated to node two. So even if Kubernetes moves the pod to other node, it will not move the data because data is not getting replicated on its own, right? So that's where your node becomes a single point of failure in host path. So that's one of the challenge. Now, how do you overcome this situation? One option could be that you can create a pool sort of thing, right? You want to implement software-defined storage where you are picking the storage from all the worker nodes or all the data plane nodes. So you have three data plane nodes. You want to utilize and create a storage pool, and then you allocate a storage from there, right? So how do you do that? Yes, you have to use container native or cloud native storage solution, which are called CNS. And there are so many options out there. There are 50 plus options mentioned in CNCF landscape itself. There are a couple of them mentioned, like OpenEBS, Chef, Rook, Portworks, and many more actually, right? So many solutions are there that handle this part. And how do they handle? So see, all these solutions come with various options related to replication and backup, restore, and all. So how, and this helps in handling cluster level failure. So assume that you have a failure. So we are going higher up, right? So we discuss about pod, we discuss about node, storage. Okay. I mean, all that is good, but entire cluster failed, right? Entire Kubernetes cluster is not working for some reason. And you want to fail over to, obviously you have to fail over to other Kubernetes cluster, right? And that cluster failure situation can only be handled by multi-cluster setup, right? So, and both the clusters should be having some sort of peering. They should know each other. And then you need to have some method to copy data from source cluster to destination cluster, or active cluster to passive cluster, or active cluster, whatever. I mean, all possible scenarios are there. So how do you handle cluster failure? First rule of thumb, never mix your data plane nodes and storage nodes. So though I was giving an example where I was saying that we want to utilize storage from all the data plane node, but ideally that should not have been done, right? So in high availability architecture, you should remember that your storage node should be separate from your data plane nodes, right? So you should have, let's say, three data plane node and three storage nodes, okay? So that you don't have direct dependency between these two, right? And you can also run a storage node in HA mode. You can, I mean, this gives, you more resiliency, and this is much more common architecture actually. Now, which solution to choose? So I've mentioned in previous slide that you have option of doing backup, restore, sync replication, async replication, right? So which one to choose? Now, well, it depends on your RPU, RTU, what you are trying to achieve. So if you have, let's say, you don't have zero RPU, right? And you have larger RTO, then we are good with backup restore. Just take a backup, or rather you take regular backups, copy those backups to somewhere in case of disaster, take that backup, restore it, you're up and running. But that will take a good amount of time, right? So the recovery time objective will be high. And moreover, recovery point objective will also be there because you cannot ensure that there will not be any data loss. So you will lose your data till your last backup, right? Now, if you want to reduce your RPO and you want to have very small RTO, go with the async replication kind of option. Now, async replication has only one challenge, that it does not guarantee zero RPO. So there might still be data loss because even if you go with the 1 minute of replication frequency, you still have a possibility of losing that 1 minute worth of data. So if that is perfectly all right, it's okay. You can go with async. But if that is not all right, go with sync replication. And sync replication gives you zero data loss option, but it comes with a stricter requirement. And when I say strict requirement means you need to have less than 10 millisecond latency between source and target cluster. This is quite difficult to achieve, right? So that's why not many setup requires and go for sync replication. Right, okay. So this is how you handle cluster failure. But the question is it must to use a storage-based high availability option? So far I was talking only about storage, right? To handle various failures or to design, in other words, to design highly available application, I was only focusing on storage-based solution. Is it a must? No, it is not must. You can have, or rather it is recommended to use application or workload-based high availability option wherever it is available. Right? Let's say database. So in database, you have different DR option or high availability option. Go with those options rather than storage layer option because of inherent benefit that comes with workload level or workload type based high availability, right? And with all this information, this is a very simplistic architecture that we should try to implement for any highly available application in Kubernetes. So what you need to have, first, you need to have two clusters running in two data centers, right? Cluster one, cluster two, and those two clusters should have at least async replication, if not sync replication. And you should have separate data plane, control plane and storage nodes, and they all should be multiple. Like I have shown three nodes each, and then I'm showing a sync replication or async replication. Now, if you have to visualize this architecture in terms of public cloud, let's say, okay, you are using any EKS cluster, then how do you do that? I mean, how do you implement this? So what you need to do here is you need to use two availability zones, right? AZ1, AZ2. Have Kubernetes cluster one, EKS1 running on AZ1, EKS2 running on AZ2. And then you and implement some storage replication kind of solution between AZ1 and AZ2 so that your data is constantly replicated. And so many tools provide this functionality out of the box. So you don't need to really search for EBS replication option. They do that very nicely. So go with some external tools. Now, what are the key takeaways? So storage is the heart of it. You might have understood by now. So choosing the right storage solution is extremely important. So let's say your requirement is about sync replication or you want zero RPO. Then you need to figure out the right tool which provides sync replication because not all I would say there are less than five solutions as of now in Kubernetes world which provide sync replication, right? And use multi-zone cluster, right? So it's not necessary that you should have two different clusters. You can have single control plane and two different data plane running in two different AZs, right? That is quite possible. And if you are trying to do it using open source way and in do it yourself way, then there are two big challenges. One is cluster pairing, So how do you connect cluster A and cluster B, which are in different data centers or different availability zone and all? You have to have some additional software and additional security consideration there. And there are some open source solution also for cluster pairing. And there are management overhead. So setting up this kind of replication is quite challenging. There are a lot of commands that one has to run, and it's not really fully automated. Now, use workload specific HA option. As I mentioned in previous slide, wherever you have an option of workload specific high availability, then we should go for it. That's the best thing to do. Okay. Single control plane setup for multi-site Kubernetes is another design option that is coming up. So yeah, there are certain solutions which are there in the market where you can still have same control plane and keep on just having multiple data planes, right? In different availability zones or data centers. So that is it. Thank you so much for your high availability and your attention during the session. Thank you so much.